Today, talking with Danny Pesci, Mr. Oh shoot, what was it? Mr. Did you in one of your videos? I think you said White Patrick Ewing. I thought that
I
was.
have a couple different. Yes, I am the white Russell Westbrook. So you better go grab your checkbook. Here comes the white Russell Westbrook.
See,
Yes, I.
I don't know if that works anymore because he's really
Yeah.
kind of struggling this year, it seems.
Bro, I'm in LA, so I'm a huge Laker fan, like die hard, and it's just so disturbing to see what's going on right now. It just pisses me off so much. It's like I saw some today, LeBron James is 20 points away from becoming second all-time scorer behind Karl Malone, and now it's there he's doing better and better and better, but just the team is just terrible, so.
Yeah, well, I mean it. I don't know. So I picked up, and obviously, I see Curry in your background, and you're a basketball guy. I've always been a fan. I was always terrible at playing, but I always thought the Lakers would be a disaster. I just didn't think it would be this bad. Like I
The
don't know. I
worst
just
thing.
it never really makes sense. You know, the formula has always been surround LeBron with shooters, and you can't, like, it's the same thing that's always happened when you get Harden and Durant. I mean, if you have too many guys that are all ball dominant, it's going to be a rough time. So I'm not surprised, but obviously you're a door-to-door sales guy, and I believe by your profile you're also a former comedian. Is that right?
Yeah, I did theater for a long time, and so I did about theater for about 8, 9 years, and that's where I really got my drive to go do sales because I always wanted to be an actor and kind of just tricked myself into thinking sales is like an acting game, and I started acting really good, and then I became really good, and now I'm teaching some of the stuff that I've learned to get good at it. I've spent 15 years in commission only door-to-door sales, and I've made quite a good living for myself. Now I'm teaching people how to do it in shorter amounts of time.
Awesome, man. So tell me about your journey, because obviously, yeah, I'm assuming when you first started with door-to-door sales, did you think it was like gonna be such a big part of your life? Did you do it as like a temporary thing? Like, where were you at when you started compared to now?
Yeah, so a lot of guys are like, well, dude, you're so committed and so focused. How are you like that? Like at the beginning, I wasn't at all. And most people try to get to that point where they're super focused and super all in, but it doesn't start off that way. And you can't expect yourself to be bought in. I wasn't that bought into this job. I was only doing it because initially when I got recruited, it was, hey, work 4 months of the year and you make enough money so you can do whatever you want the next 8 months of the year. So that's how my first, 5, 6, 7 years started while I was doing theater simultaneously is I would go and make a bunch of money. And I'd go and perform. I'd buy theater space. I'd pay for classes. I'd pay for coaches to come in and teach my tribe, my client, my troupe, as we called it, improv troupe. And so I eventually started getting good at it. And I was like, man, I'm making really good money. And something just hit me where I overheard a conversation with, my coaches, where I looked up to them. I'm like, dude, you guys are the best. And they were talking about how they're sharing a one bedroom apartment with four people in it. And I was like, holy crap, dude, what the hell is that the future of what I'm going to be getting into? And I had just made like 300 grand that year. And I'm like, bro, I could buy a house and like buy this whole theater. Like, what am I doing?
Well,
Freaking.
and it's such a like a you always hear the struggle, the starving actor. Like, you hear about all these people that before they had their big break, they were living in like dirty one bedroom shacks, or they're sharing it with a billion people, or they're basically homeless and they get their break. And but it's kind of interesting because you were like, your side hustle at the, I guess it kind of was your side hustle at the time, was something that was bringing home the bank, which was probably unique amongst your acting cohort, so to speak.
Yeah, they were freaking out, dude. They're like, what is this? I tried to bring some of them into it, but a lot of times, like, they didn't have that, like, gumption to go out and hustle really hard. They were, doing just enough to get by so that they could do theater. Whereas I did so much overboard at work so that I could dominate theater. And I always had that entrepreneur mindset growing up. Like, I never liked, being, I tried to audition for this main company in Los Angeles and I didn't get booked for it. So I created my own theater group and like did everything I wanted there. I used to want to be a DJ and I practice all the time, but no one would book me to play parties. So I eventually just booked my own parties and booked myself. And then I started booking DJs and the guys that wouldn't book me, now I'm telling them when they're playing. And basketball too, as well. I wanted to play college basketball and didn't work out. So I'm like, don't worry about it. I'm going to go start my own team. And then I played in leagues. So it's like, you know, consistent not getting what I want taught me that if I'm going to want to go out and do something, I got to go create it myself rather than waiting for somebody to pick me. I got so pissed because, bro, I was so good at theater. Like, I was really, really talented. But something where they didn't like my personality or something like that came into play where I didn't make this comedy troupe. And it really pissed me off. I'm like, bro, I don't like being at the mercy of kissing ass and, you know, not the best people get on these companies. So I was like, I'm going to go do it myself. And, you know, I'm at a place now where I could literally buy that business and run it how I wanted to do it. But it's literally a bleeding cow business and our bleeding business. They don't make any money. So I wouldn't do that. But I could now because of that mindset that if you want something, you got to go out and make it happen for yourself. Because no one was going to come and book me for their shows. No one's going to do any of that. I was good. I mean, I wasn't like LeBron James good or anything like that, but still it kind of rubbed me the wrong way. And I'm like, dude, I'll go. I can do it. Fine. I'll do it myself. So that was a big lesson that I learned in life. And that's why I love this job. And it's so pure because in sales, literally no one's telling you how much you can make. The more you make, actually, the more they want you to do better. So when I got that aligned where my upline actually wanted me to do better, like, boom, the sky was the freaking limit.
That's awesome, man. And so is that kind of what happened with like with Knockstar, where you guys in a way saw the need for something, or you saw that there no one was doing it the way that you wanted, so you wanted to kind of go out and create a community that was able to really kind of unite guys like that?
Yeah, I mean, I initially started Door-to-Door Con with Sam back in the day at the early stages of it. And I don't know, do you know much about Door-to-Door Con or a little
yeah.
bit?
Yeah, well, I mean, I know about it. I've never attended. I do know quite a bit about it.
It's like the staple for the door-to-door industry. It's a big convention. Everybody gets together. And, you know, I was me and Sam were originally the 1-2 punch for it. And then just things didn't really line up. We separated before the event started. And, you know, I always knew that I could easily do that and do it better. And I was still in the trenches at the time. Sam was kind of, his career was winding down on the door-to-door side. So he wanted to ramp up the consulting side. So for me, I was still full-fledged, like all in at the event. Like I was about to get a payout from, you know, the equity pool that they made up and never really ended up much happening because of it. And so I was still bought into the vision. And then, you know, after I left that company, after Vivint went public, I looked at how much money that long-term incentive plan, they called it LTIP, was going to pay me. And I like almost started crying because I felt so deceived, so tricked. I gave literally 10 years of my life to an organization, like all in, blood packed. And it didn't turn out to be a tenth of what, you know, we all envisioned it would be. And it was disappointing. So I made a commitment to stay at the company until that happened. And then as soon as it did, I left, went to a small company and like 10x'd my results, and then took the high from my managing and regional managing and sales year, and then started the consulting business. And since then, it's just pretty much taken off. And we're taking a majority of the market share right now in the door-to-door space for solar specifically. So that's been our main focus is diving into solar sales and then riding this niche or whatever market. And then we're going to start branching out to,
it's a, you know, yeah. Niche. Such an awkward word.
Yeah.
Awkward. Yeah. That's those two words together. Awkward. Once again, it's kind of like, it almost fits the theme of, you feel or you were in a position where you were expecting or you expected something that you deserved and you didn't get it. And then you wanted to find a way to go out and do something your way where you did get it. And it's kind of, you're seems to be a trend so far, and we've only been talking for 15 minutes. So tell me about what it is. I mean, I think solar, the reason I fell in love with it on the marketing and online side was just because when you like when it clicks for you, it's like, oh, dude, this is like the best industry ever. Like I used to be trying to get my acquisition cost below $100 for someone who had a $200 profit. Like this is makes so much more sense. Is that kind of how you're because you were door to door for 14 years, but I'm pretty sure the majority of that wasn't in solar. What
Correct.
was it like when you kind of made that transition?
Yeah, so I was in alarms for 13 years, and I'm like one of very few people who've sold like 300, and I did that for 10 years straight, and that's like there's only a few people that have ever been able to do it because it's extremely difficult. I made a lot of sacrifices. Never been married. Don't have any kids. I've lived in a suitcase most of my life, and that's just a sacrifice people aren't willing to make. Like I literally gave up everything. I gave up my acting career, gave up connection with my family, missed funerals, missed weddings, literally on the road my entire, pretty much my whole life, to accomplish that. And so after I've accomplished those accolades, that's when I got into my coaching business. And I'm like, bro, if I could do that, then I could show people how to do it a better way and not have to sacrifice their whole life to get these results. And so that's where that came from. And, I think at the end of the day, it proved like with online marketing and stuff like that, you never know if these gurus are legit or not. And that's what's so beautiful about door to door is you can make a couple phone calls to tell if somebody's real. And why we've had such success in our business is because if anyone was to fact check me or Taylor, my partner, like, yep, they've done it. They were there. They've seen it. And so that's been really good to know that we deliver a product. Not from theory, but from practice. And so, like the stuff that we train on is very applicable. And the cool part about security, it was so much harder to sell than solar. And so, when I transitioned from security to solar, it was the easiest thing, and it was unbelievable because, like, how much of an easier sale it was, and how much more money you made, it just was a no-brainer. And the techniques that I learned at security. I took what was really, really good and applied it to solar, and it's a unique spin on how to sell it. And so that's why the results were so good. And that's why training and using our material that we took, it's kind of like Elon Musk when he went into the car industry. He thought differently to an old industry, and I came in with my spin on it and the way I sold alarms and added it to solar, and the results have been amazing.
So give us a little like a little bit more info on that. Like, so what exactly from alarms did you kind of bring to solar or use to kind of craft your pitch that you saw other people weren't doing?
Yeah, so with my, I do a lot of question-based selling. I'm a question-based salesman. And so what I do is when I go through a sales process with solar, I get them to blame, take the blame off of the company they're with and blame it on the grid. So my sales process is all about building pain in the grid and letting them know there's nothing they can do about it. They have no way to fix the grid. The government's not going to do it. The only way they can do it is just put freaking band-aids on this grid to try to get electricity to people. So the only way to get around that is to get solar. So I build so much pain in the grid by question-based selling that at the end, the only solution they have is to go solar. So I get them to sell themselves on why. Just like when I was doing takeovers for alarms, a lot of times they have phone lines or old antiquated cellular service monitored systems. And I just tell them, hey, look, what happens when 5G comes out? What happens when 4G comes out? Hey, what happens if someone cuts the phone line? They get them to agree that no matter what, they're going to have to get it upgraded. And so I get my clients to agree no matter what, they're going to have to get solar. Because I'm a firm believer everybody is going to have to get it eventually one day. Because the grid is 130 years old, and we're buying with this electric car boom that's happening, these gas prices going up, it's going to crash the grid. And it's going to be a point where the government's going to say, sorry, you got to put on your roof no matter what. Because if the grid goes down, people die. And it makes the United States very accessible to hackers and all sorts of stuff. There's a lot of crazy things that people don't know about the grid. And if we keep putting pressure on it, then it's like, bro, we're all in a lot of trouble. So that's why I feel solar is such an awesome sale because I can literally tie them down to if they don't want solar, what, you're going to cancel your electricity bill? Oh, sorry, you're going to have to keep this no matter what. Okay, is it fair to say that you're never going to get rid of your utility bill? Yes. Well, if there was a cheaper option, if your utility company came to you and gave you a cheaper option, would you at least look at it? Yeah, sure. Okay, so the only difference is I'm not your utility company. Before, you couldn't have another option because it was too expensive. Now with these new programs, you redirect the payment you're paying your utility company to the payment on these panels for a cheaper fixed price or for a fixed rate that never goes up on it. Or a little bit higher rate that's locked in for life. And so all of these things, it's like, if you can bring up enough points and get your customer to agree with it, they're going to go forward with your offer. And that's been my way of selling, is really, really diving in and dialing in on that emphasis that if you tell them, they're not going to listen. If your neighbor tells them, they'll be open to it. But if you get the customer to tell you why they should do it, oh yeah. You'll get selling all the customers sell themselves. It's easy. Security, there's some people you can just harp to them in their ear, but they don't think they need it. Oh, I got my dogs, my guns. I live in a nice neighborhood. Some people, you can't switch them. They can't switch to paying that. But solar, they have a payment that they have to pay no matter what. And you have an alternative that's better for them, better for the community, and better for the world. So it's a no-brainer.
Yeah, with security, it's almost like there's a lot of people that are just truly indifferent about it.
Yeah.
Like that's like, you know, it's the world we live in. Alarm system's not going to, if someone wants to come in and steal them, like it's not going to make a difference. They're still going to get away, blah, blah, blah. But like with solar, I like that I think that's anything that a good coach or trainer makes it for, especially the people that are beginners that aren't used to overcoming objections. They're not really sure what they're going to encounter, but kind of keeping them focused on the main thing, which is getting them focused on the grid. Yep. Rather than their monthly bill, or rather than solar itself, just kind of helping them to get to that point is super important. I think also it reminds me of when I'm following, or when I'm helping people with their follow-up, like checking in with past customers or leads that they have in their text database. Yep. And like I always, like one of the things I harp on people about is like if they say, or like we always have to ask them, like, have you made the switch yet? Have you gone solar yet? But what we're doing, yep, is we're getting the customer to kind of keep in their mind that they're going to make the switch eventually. Like once we get them to tell us that, and once they've kind of accepted that, we know that it's going to happen and they know it's going to happen. And then it's just a matter of why is it not going to happen now? And yep, that is, once you get over that, it's pretty much a slam dunk, hopefully.
Yeah. And that's one thing we talk about is like the urgency. And the way you build urgency is obviously takeaways and techniques, but really the more pain that you can build with a customer, the more change they're going to want to make. So if you're trying to get your customer to do it today, you have to really dive in on building pain. And you really, because people buy for two reasons, because they love something or because it solves a problem. When I say build pain, that what I refer to, what I mean by that is causing a problem so that they change. So for me, my job is to build such a problem that they can't do anything about, that they want to change. And so most people bash on the utility companies and try to say, oh, this utility companies are screwing you. They're really not. They're using the grid that's an antiquated system that they're kind of tied behind their backs. Even the utility companies want you to get sold, like, because it's too much pressure on them. And so that's why I'm like.
Well, and also from a teaching and coaching perspective, if you get people to have that mindset, then it doesn't matter if they're knocking in Arizona or Florida or what neighborhood they're in with the utility company. I mean, it's all kind of the same problem. Yeah, the numbers are different. It's local incentives might be slightly different, but at the same time, your conversation should be the same. And that's because you're focused on the root of the problem, which is the grid.
Yep.
Fascinating, man. So how many solar companies have you helped since? I mean, it sounds like you've only been in solar for a few years, but obviously you kind of dived into this industry. I'm assuming you've been working with companies kind of all over the country. Where have you worked primarily, and like, what have you noticed about different markets?
Yeah, so I started, my first solar deal was in 2016. I was the first the second office that Vivint Solar and Vivint Security merged together on. Back in 2016, they tried a new program because Vivint Solar and Vivint Security have never really been aligned. It's always been very, very separate. And so in 2016, they came together for a brief couple months, and I was in charge of the security side, adding on solar. So I would go out there with Adam Cox in California in Victorville, and we would go, I would sell security, and then he would come in and add the solar on there. So the first deal I closed was in 2016. The next year I started working with Legacy and adding on solar to my accounts out there. Me and Jory Sullivan were slapping deals in Greenville, South Carolina. He runs all of the East Coast now for Legacy. So, and then after that, as 2020 came around, a lot of the alarm industry switched. So after COVID hit, this solar thing just started really taking off, because it wasn't, the pay wasn't that good up until like a year or two ago. Like what ended up happening was, is a lot of these mega dealers started losing people because they would go directly to the installers, and the installers would pay them a large margin. And so now the commission structure has gone astronomical. I've never seen anything like this in door to door. And so, you know, nothing has been able to pay close to as well as solar is right now for such an easy sale. And so now what ended up happening is all these different guys that are leaving their industries are just going direct to the installers. And, you know, these old alarm vets, all the people that run solar companies now came from a different industry. There's very few that started in solar and have grown through the ranks of it. Like Legacy was, I was in Legacy's region when they were an alarm company at Pinnacle. So 2012 is when Legacy started at Pinnacle, and I was their top rep that year. And then 2013, I was the top rep that year too for Legacy. And then 2014 is when Doug Robinson broke off and started Legacy Power. And then John Frampton, my other regional, he started Solar City Direct. And so they were the huge, they were big companies back in the day. And so, yeah, it's a crazy history. And so I've always been around it. I know all the people that, you know, basically started these big companies, and they were all my managers at one point. So I've always known it. I've just been so good at security that if you're the pay, I made more money as a top performing alarm sales rep and manager in the solar side. And it just was in the last 2 or 3 years where the income potential shifted, where I was like, well, no, I actually can make a lot more money doing solar. And I was finding less and less people wanted to do security, and more people could get behind solar. So it was, from a recruiting standpoint, it was a more attractive offer for the next generation of newcomers.
Yeah, I think with security as well, a lot of the kind of innovations in the, like with the Nest home systems, and a lot of people started looking at other alternatives than the larger and more expensive home security systems. And obviously that has a minor impact as well. So you mentioned, like, so we talked about a little bit, you were doing improv and comedy. Did you ever do stand-up comedy or just improv? You did stand-up comedy?
Yeah.
Let me ask you, who's your favorite comedian?
Rodney Dangerfield.
Oh, man. Yeah. See, my next question was going to be, how, rest in peace to Rodney Dangerfield, but how do you think he would have done on The Doors? And I think he would have been a dynamite for sure.
Yeah, he'd have been hilarious. The thing is most people, you know, don't realize that, like, you know, just because you're funny, the part about this job is the sales, just because you're funny doesn't mean you're going to sell a lot. What I thought that because I was a natural, like, gifted at humor and witty, that I'd be good. The real skill set is the mindset to be able to take no's and keep going. Mm-hmm. That is the hard part, because, you know, a lot of comedians mask their depression and mask their insecurities with their humor. And when you go door to door, you're faced with so much rejection. You really have to look at those skeletons in your closet. And that scares the shit out of a lot of people.
And no, for sure. I guess I wasn't really saying because he's a comedian, he would be successful. Like, but yeah. You know what? Because I think about it, because my favorite comedian is Norm MacDonald. Was Norm MacDonald.
R.I.P.
And he would be awful. I mean, at least because he's, you can't really, it's hard for him because I don't know if we ever saw the real Norm MacDonald. So like the character that he as a comedian, he would be like the most aloof guy, probably get the cops called on him because they think there's this random crazy guy walking around that's talking about solar and a billion other things. But it is just interesting to think about.
It's funny.
Yeah. And as improv, I think a lot of salespeople see or understand how sales, people that are successful at sales and overcoming objections and anything that's thrown at them, a lot of times that kind of is almost like an improv conversation where they have to be quick on their feet and be able to point the direction and steer the conversation where they want it to go. Do you ever do any type of like sales training or recommend it for people that is kind of similar to improv?
Oh yeah. When I ran my teams, like as I was doing meetings every single day, like during the summertime, I would do improv in all of my meetings. Like those would be the highlights of the meetings because I like to get guys having their energy up. I like them to warming up their mind because a lot of times as managers don't warm up their mind. The sales reps are sitting in the correlations. They start thinking of their goals, but then they get nervous. And you know, I found that if you start playing and getting into your body, it loosens up a lot of that nervous energy. And by playing, it releases endorphins. And if you can tie in education into games, people learn a lot more. So I used to tie all of these theater games into sales and bridge the gap from, hey, if you're going to do a theater game, here's how it applies in the business world and tie it together. And guys would learn like crazy. And it would really help them perform on the doors.
Yeah, I mean, it does. It has to be fun, right? I mean, when I was in the fitness world as a personal trainer, fitness manager, and I remember everyone dreaded role playing. Like, role playing was like the thing. I mean, number one, the reason a lot of personal trainers struggle is because they care about working out. I mean, no one got into personal training because they were like an incredible salesperson. They got into personal training probably because they spent enough time in a gym that they're like, oh, this is a job that I can work. But role playing was always like the most dreaded and boring, and no one enjoyed it. And a lot of times it's because if you don't enjoy it, it's just something that no one's ever going to really get any value out of because it's something that, number one, doesn't feel real. Number two, it doesn't actually provide you with any skills other than things that you can recall, but you're never quick enough to recall them in real time. And that's always something that I think is interesting because I think not enough salespeople do role playing. And Solar, too. I think Solar kind of has this mindset where they hire as many people as possible and throw them and see what sticks. And they don't really necessarily invest the time and the energy.
And that's not just solar, bro. That's
Well, I mean,
across
that's sales in
the
general, but
board.
it's even worse in solar, I guess. I mean, I don't know. It's pretty bad everywhere. But what is it that you look for when you're recruiting or hiring, or what do you recommend managers do when they're looking and trying to find successful door-to-door salesmen?
Yeah. And so I get that a lot. I recruited for most of my career. And, you know, I think I recruited about 1,000, over 1,000 people in my day. And, you know, one thing that really sticks with me is my mentor, Jeff Mendez, taught me is you manage systems, not people. So many times managers are so quick to manage people, but you can't scale people, you can scale systems. And so you lead the people, but you manage the systems. So what that means is you set up what gets done for the week, and then you lead the people to it. But if they don't fall into the system, then they fall out and you replace them. And you can't be emotional about it because the thing is, like a lot of these guys, some will, some won't, so what? A lot of these guys will come through here and they'll not only quit, but understand that that isn't anything personal. They quit on everything that they do. They quit at the last job. They quit there. Why are they working for you now? Oh, because they quit their last place. So unfortunately, I feel like this is a jumping around marketplace right now. And for me, I've always prided myself on never doing that. I never left a company. The company has left me. My first company, Platinum Protection, went out of business. I was forced to leave. Pinnacle Security went out of business. I was forced to leave. And then Vivint was the first one that I ever left because I made that commitment that I wanted to wait till the company went public. And I did. And I think I stayed there a little too long. I got stuck in being a top sales rep's role rather than transitioning into being a business owner, like my other buddies did, Doug Robinson and Max Britton, who runs Sunder now. Who else? John Frampton, who started Solar City Direct. Like all these guys I worked with started their own businesses, and I was so emotionally attached to being a top sales rep, I missed out a lot of opportunities because of that. So.
Yeah, it's interesting because you don't hear a lot about that in solar, that loyalty. I mean, the people that stay with companies for an extended duration of time. But
Yeah.
it sounds like you did that, and obviously Vivint was probably one of the biggest, if not the biggest, company that really started to put solar on the map here in the United States. But now it's changing. What do you think the industry is going? Do you think there's going to be more? I think Jake Hess actually just had a post like a few weeks back about he kind of sees installation companies and the larger companies bringing more sales and more teams like in-house and kind of making relationships more professional and concrete. Where do you see the industry going?
Same thing. It already happened with alarms. It's going to happen with solar too. Back in the day, there was like 10 or 20 different alarm companies. They all offered the same product, same service. So it was just who could pay you the most. And then over the years, it started consolidating down to when it was basically like Vivint and like two or three other companies. Vivint and ADT are the prominent alarm companies now these days. The same thing will happen with solar. Basically, these sales organizations, the barrier to entry is very low. We're going to see more government regulations. There's going to be more hoops to jump through to get this stuff done properly, because there's a lot of inexperienced sales reps that shouldn't be running their own dealers that have no genuine care for the company, and they're just trying to make a big buck, bang for their buck.
What? No, that can't be true. No,
Yes,
of
believe
course,
it or
yes.
not.
Yeah, I think everyone always points to like Australia as far as like solar goes, where it becomes because I mean it,
So
once
cheap.
what was that?
So cheap out in Australia.
Yeah, it's so cheap and it's the I mean obviously when that happens the commissions go away and
Yeah,
it's be
nothing.
but it's because that's the time when society as a whole kind of acknowledges that look, where everyone's gonna go solar, every house is gonna have solar. It's just like it's just a normal purchase, like activating your cable or whatever. When that happens, obviously the skill, the sales, a lot of the sales process becomes automated and there's less work, but that's kind of where the commissions go. What do you as you've been in this industry a long time, what is it that you if you were talking to someone who is day one, this they're about to go and knock their first door, what type of advice do you give someone in that position?
Yeah, you got to get clear on three things: your vision, your mindset, and your technique, in that order. If you don't have a good vision, stop, get your vision dialed in. After that, once you have
So
your
when
vision
we're talking about
dialed in,
vision, are you talking about long-term vision, short-term, their
long
goals,
term.
like what type of stuff are
The
this
cheat, the cheat code, the cheat code with this is how can you have to look at this job as a way, as a means to an end. How can you use this job to accomplish your goals? My goal was to entertain from stage hundreds of people and make people laugh. My initial was eventually I can do a comedy and perform like stand-ups and open mics and all that stuff. And what ended up happening was now instead of me, I'm living my dream now, but instead of telling jokes on stage, I'm telling sales training. So I'm on stage in front of thousands of people, but my content's a little bit different. So my vision was always to get there, and now it's come full circle because I spent so many years in the trenches. Now when I go on stage, I have an audience because I earned it by putting in the work. So number one, know what your big goal is out of this. And so it changes. And so when you start this job, your goals are going to change to where it's at now. That was a big vision. One of my smallest visions, like when I first started, is I want to make so much money, my high school basketball coach regretted not playing me senior year. And then he found out I made a couple $1 million and he's like, bro, way to go, man. And I was like, that's right, finally. And so then that goal was gone. He found out, now what am I going to do? And so that's when I started having bigger goals. So your goals grow as you grow. Then dialing in your mindset, knowing that this is going to be tough. What do you do when you start getting your teeth kicked in on the doors? How do you train yourself? That comes in with coaching. That comes in with buying programs. That comes into going to seminars, strengthening your mindset so when the world starts hitting you, you're able to defend yourself. Because the world never stops hitting you. You just have to get strong enough to handle it. Like it never becomes easier. You just have to get better. You have to develop your mindset so that when you start getting all these no's and you start getting beat up, you don't quit. You keep going. You keep going. And that is like taking a shower. You have to consistently do it over and over and over again. And then the last piece is the technique, the words that come out of your mouth, how you say and how you do when you engage with a client. You show up to a customer, are you nervous? Yeah, because you don't know what the hell you're going to say. Would you be nervous if you knew exactly what the customer was going to say and you knew what you were going to say to overcome that objection? Not only one way, but three different ways. How do you overcome when they tell you no? What are three things you can do to get around it? All these different things I train my people on so that when they go to a door, they're not nervous because they know exactly what's going to happen. It's like, bro, they're going to get the deal. Well, they're not. And if the customer goes along the line, they can just overcome certain objections, prepare them. We give them a roadmap of what to do to get a customer on board. And so if you knew what you were going to do, you wouldn't be nervous. It's like your first time on a freeway. Were you nervous when you jumped in your car and you got on a freeway? Absolutely. Now, it's like, bro, you don't even think about it.
Unless you're my wife and I'm driving, then you might. Then my wife, when I yell at, I've been driving for almost, I've been driving 15 plus years now.
Yeah.
Damn, I never thought about that. And never been in an accident in my life. But still, it's just the way, knock on wood. But that's just the way, you know, some people are. It is interesting though, because it's, it's similar to stage fright. What I think is funny is as a salesperson, I've looked into I'm practicing and kind of attempting stand-up comedy at times because I think it's, and improv, because I see the relationship and how it can help me to improve my sales. And you did it obviously the opposite way, where you started over there and then you came to sales and you had that kind of success. But that was gold, man. It reminded me of four of my favorite books all at once, like Begin with the End of Mind. There's a quote, I think from, I don't remember who, but motivation is like bathing. We have to practice it daily, you know. All this kind of stuff that's just kind of super valuable. So, what is? And I don't want to take up too much of your time, so I just have a couple more questions. But what do you enjoy the most? So, if you only had to do one for the rest of your life, knocking doors personally, on your own, speaking in front of large groups, or one-on-one training with individuals, which one do you think you enjoy the most? And, or is it kind of balanced now? Because obviously you've transitioned into this role, and I'm assuming this role is probably going to become more and more a larger part of your life. You plan, it does sound like you enjoy doors, but most people I know, they don't expect to be knocking doors when they're 65. So which one of those do you enjoy the most?
No, I don't foresee myself knocking doors much more in the future. I mean, I've done it. I don't think there's very few people on planet Earth that have knocked as long as I have. So I've earned the right to transition in my career. And, you know, and this is really what I'm trying to focus on. I've done it long enough where I can teach the principles and still stay sharp. And so the thing I see myself speaking a lot on stage and coaching large groups and providing transformational experiences. So with my year-long mastermind that I curate every week, we have a call and stuff. And my main goal is to train these guys so that they can go train their people. And so I see myself focusing predominantly on my private community and really having these guys grow. And then my real estate portfolio, that's a big thing that I'm pushing on right now. But in terms of my career, I foresee myself doing very heavily in this space and consulting and predominantly speaking and doing training from stage. I think probably most of it is on stage. I'm trying to get away from the one-on-one stuff. I like group settings because I can get my message across further. I have a really big goal, and so it's going to require me to spend more time with masses, which is why, you know, these big events help me out with that a lot.
Do you think you'll go and knock doors occasionally just to get that feeling back?
If needed to. I know a lot of our clients want me to do that or want Taylor to do that. We're trying to steer away from it because that's doing the training.
We want I don't necessarily mean even doing it to
just for fun to go out.
To get that feeling, you know. I feel like you see with athletes all the time. There's some athletes that they retire and they're a basketball player. They never touch a basketball ever again. There's guys that still go out in their backyard and they shoot hoops every day just because it's something they love, you know?
Yeah.
And I think obviously there's, with knocking on doors, it's not quite as many people love it, but there are definitely that feeling that you get, I'm sure, is something that a lot of people do enjoy, and that you kind of like those endorphins. So I was just curious as far as if there was any part of you that really, I mean, you must love knocking doors. I mean, you just said yourself, you probably knock down doors.
I really, I'm not a huge fan of it. I just, bro,
Okay,
I
well, I
just,
don't blame you. I think it, I mean,
yeah.
I think, do you love the feeling of knocking doors? Like the feeling that you get when you've done, when you have found that success?
Well, so the thing is most guys don't realize this, but the high from closing deals is the best you've ever had. And so for me, to go out and knock isn't fun. I go out to close. So when I go out and work, I'm like, bro, I don't like this uncomfortable feeling, so I need to get a sale. So what happens is I've, conditioned my body to not like that. So to get myself out of that state of nervousness, I sell and I go and perform, so I get that high of closing. So that's my body that I've tricked it into go out and performing. Like, and the thing is I'm not a huge fan of knocking doors. And no one, like, watching this, if you like, Taylor McCarthy is probably one of the only guys that really enjoys doing it. So, but for me, like, I just do it. And you can't take too big, you can't overthink it. You just got to go out and take action. Because what happens is when we train our guys on this, is first comes the action, then comes the motivation. So if you're going out knocking, you don't need to be in love with it. You're never going to be in a position where, like, you're going to love going and talking to strangers at their house. You figure out ways to train your mindset to do it, so that this way you can, be face to face with a client and go out and perform when needed be. But yeah, for me personally, it's not something where I'm like, hell yeah, dude, let's do it. Basketball, on the other hand, yeah, bro, I love basketball. I still play all the time. Like, that's my thing.
Well, see, and there, but there, and there's also professionals of basketball that don't love basketball. Like there's it's there's obviously I'm sure there's a lot more people that love basketball than knocking doors, or else door-to-door sales would be a much larger industry than it currently is. Awesome,
And
man.
the
Tell
thing is,
me about what you're doing, what you're excited about with Knockstar, what you guys got in the works. I know you just had a big event.
yeah.
And based on what I've gathered, it sounds like that was a success. Can you tell, like, how,
Yeah.
what was it like putting that on this year?
It was the most stressful thing I've ever done in my entire life,
I can imagine.
legitimately. We completely sold out, standing room only. It was fantastic. We ran a huge event. Pretty much cost us all the money that we made. So it was very, very nerve-wracking. So not only, like, do you put all your, you go all in on something energetically wise, but financially too as well. So we went all in on it, and it paid out. It was insane. Guys had an amazing experience. I didn't hear one bad thing from anybody. And that was a really, really big thing to really, really big thing for us to realize. And, I always in life, you never think you're capable of doing something or good enough to do it. And I didn't know if I could ever put something on like together that together. And with the help from my team and, my partner, we were able to accomplish something that I never thought I'd be able to achieve in my life. And it's pretty crazy to, like, see that type of stuff happening, and you're the one in charge of it, and you're the one that created this. And it's if you've never had a family member or in your life be that person, and you're that guy, it's like, bro, holy shit. And so it was pretty surreal for me. I still don't remember what happened. I literally was, like, in La La Land the whole time. Like, I don't remember what I said. Like, it was a,
That's
yeah, because it's.
it's funny. I mean, 'cause that's when I for a while I was doing managing events, and I don't think events any of my events I ever managed was on the scale of this. How many people attended?
It's about 600, 700.
Okay. So yeah, I've done events where there's hundreds of people, a couple
Yeah.
events that I was a part of where there's thousands, but like people
Yeah.
just don't realize. Everyone, I think people, when you like, when you're thinking about the idea of like doing this event, it's like, oh yeah, it's like one day, like I can do all this and it's one day of work. And, but then the every little interaction and coordinating and is the most stressful thing of all time, because nothing is ever perfect. There's always things that go wrong. And when something goes wrong, everyone that's attending is like, oh, this is awesome, this is awesome. And meanwhile, the people that are in charge are running around behind the scenes like, oh, I'm gonna shoot myself, this is terrible, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
It's very hard to enjoy it. So did you
Yes.
enjoy, like, it sounds like it was a fun experience. Did you enjoy being there, or because you
Yeah,
were
of
so
course.
frantic, you didn't enjoy it as much as you anticipated?
So I enjoy it's weird to it's kind of almost like a shamanic experience. My mentor was training me, and when you're in front of that many people and you're conducting their energy, like you almost absorb their energy and you push it through your body, and then you accelerate it and you push it back towards them. It's a very exhausting process. And like I got home and I can't even remember two or 3 days I was completely blacked out. Like I don't remember what I did, anything. And so like it's such a high having that experience, and it's such a fun thing. And it's just once in a lifetime that you can experience that. And I can see why people get addicted to it, because it's truly exciting and a feel to be able to conduct all of that. And for
And
me, that's
I think also as someone who has probably coordinated events, you realize like how nice it is to go and be a part of it and speak, but not actually be the one like running things, you know? And
yes.
that then when you get back to like long-term goals, obviously that you can do that more, you can get up in front of people and be the speaker and be a part of the event, but not necessarily be responsible for the event. Like that kind of seems like the dream. So what else has Knockstar got going on moving forward?
Yeah, so the big thing that we're really excited about, SolarCon's coming up. So I'm going to be the MC of SolarCon. So that's another big event that's coming out in Utah. And then the next is the thing that I'm really most excited about, that's going to be my main focus probably for the next year. One of my main focuses is called an NFT project. So what's happening is a lot of our coaching programs for the sales community is at a price range for a lot of folks. $20,000 to $300,000. So a lot of our guys can't get part of access to that type of stuff. So we were thinking of what could we do to serve, a $500 to $1,000 ticket cost range. And it's like, well, this NFT thing has been coming out and it's been turning a lot of heads. And what would be a really cool project and a good utility that we could drop and provide a ton of value for our people, and create a community of guys who want to, up-level themselves. And so that's what's so cool about door-to-door. It's like everybody that's in this space, or sales in general, if you don't get better, you get worse. And so everybody wants to get better, and where can you put a place for everybody to come together? And like this NFT is a great starting spot for it. So we developed this thing called Sales Wolves. And so Sales Wolves is a project with limited amount of images that we're going to be selling. And so they're going to have different traits and stuff like that. We'll drop more later down the line when it starts to come out. But basically, it's going to get you access to coaching and a coaching group, where every month we're going to bring in a guest speaker who's going to do the training for us. And they're going to train on XYZ, yada, 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 this or that. And the four, we're gonna, every quarter, we're going to bring in one of the gurus. So we're in talks with Jordan Belfort, Brad Lee, Tom Hopkins, and Brian Tracy. So some of the gurus of the sales game, where to go to one of their events would cost you a lot of money. And so with us being able to bring that to our community, where the price point's 500 to $1,000, and you get access to all of those calls, it's a home run. And so that's the thing that we're really, really excited about. And I think it's going to be a big home run, and we're going to continue to invest into that community going forward. So that's my big thing I'm looking forward to. Oh, you're on mute.
Sorry, my son was screaming in the other room, and sometimes the microphone picks it up, so I mute it. NFTs are so, I don't know, I can't, because I feel like I'm on like, I love crypto. I've been interested and involved, and I've been aware of it for years, but it's just hard to really grasp how big NFTs are currently and how big they're gonna be. Because like Gary Vaynerchuk's always talking like every single thing that we like your ticket that you take on the plane is going to be an NFT and everything like that. And I have seen people that have done similar things where they're using it as a membership platform, and it's a very cool way to put your things behind a paywall, but then also whatever the NFT, I mean, I'm assuming your members are going to be able to transfer it and buy and sell, and it's going to increase in value and all that kind of stuff. So that sounds very, very cool, very interesting, and definitely different. I don't think I've seen anything in the solar space yet that's similar to that. Is that going to be just solar? Is that going to be just all door-to-door sales?
Sales general. Yeah,
Awesome.
sales general.
Cool, man. Well, I look forward to that one more time. What was it going to be called?
Sales Wolves, and you can get it
Sales
on my,
Wolves.
yeah, Sales Wolves. It's going to be on my Instagram, Danny Pessy, DannyPessSSY. So on there is where I'm going to do a lot of my updates. And right now, you guys can join the Discord. So if you're watching this and you want to find out more about the project, join the Discord. And so it's just going to be a community of salesmen that, you know, are going to deal with problems that they have on the doors, in their job, or in life. Just a community of people just up leveling each other and helping out. That's, you know, it's going to be exciting because this is one of those things where there's a community of salespeople, but there's not a real place for everyone to kind of come together. And this is now with NFTs, this is a great opportunity for guys to get in and do it at an affordable price range.
Yeah, and it's also, I mean, I think one of the things that you notice with sales is there are a lot of people that realize the importance of self-development and learning and getting better. There's a lot more of that in sales than anywhere else because obviously salespeople are kind of rejecting the traditional 9-to-5 lifestyle, and that's why we're all here. So I think that sounds awesome. I'll include a link into your Instagram wherever this video and all the clips are posted. So anyone that's watching will be able to check it out. And Danny, dude, hey, I just want to say thank you so much for your time. Obviously, dude, it's very rare that you find someone who's been knocking doors for as long as you have, and who still is positive and upbeat and doesn't act like they despise everything in life. So congrats on all your success and your positivity, man, and I appreciate your time.
Thanks, bro. Absolutely, man. And just to kind of say, like, you know, life is by default or design. And if you've watched this, you know, I've made my life how I wanted to make it. And you know, just because you've been given a bad hand doesn't mean that's the bad hand you're stuck with. You make it work and you figure out where your hand in life looks like. So for me, you know,
Just get better one day at a time, and it'll be amazing where you're gonna be in 100,000 to 10,000 days.
exactly.
Awesome, man. I appreciate you, and I look forward to seeing all the stuff that you're working on. What's up, everybody? This is Kyle. Again, thank you so much for watching this episode of the Solo Pro Show. My hair, this is why I work like every day. I like my hair long and it's always a mess. But I appreciate you guys watching this. While you're here, please like, comment, subscribe, hit the notification bell, whatever you can do to support the channel and get future videos so that you can grow your solar business and your solar company.